Hello, and welcome to another episode of Film Favorites. My name is Bryce Vails, and with me as always is my good friend Aaron Chase.
Hey, Bryce.
Hello, Aaron. Well, Aaron, how are you feeling after the last episode?
I feel good. Feeling energized, feeling ready for the next one. I'm just getting in the group of things. Actually, I think so far, I don't know. I have a positive taste in my mouth from the last one, so I'm just going to try to keep riding that wave and hope that these next three are ones that aren't going to make me sad or upset or bored.
I think you'll do fine this episode. Okay. I think you'll have some things here that you'll enjoy. RoboCop was probably...
Was it my peak of the 400s?
Could be.
Okay.
If it is, that's not the worst thing in the world.
No, RoboCop is a fine film.
RoboCop is a fine film. I think we'll find something in here that you'll like as well.
So we're in the 470s.
We are officially in the 470s. Okay. This episode, we're counting down three more films from my top 500 favorite films list.
Yes.
And starting with number 479.
Okay.
Let's
hear it.
Let's get into it. My number 479 is director Gordon Douglas's 1954 film, Them! I have to say it like that because there's an exclamation mark at the end.
Is it a science fiction body swap film?
It is a science fiction giant bugs monster movie.
Oh, you know what? That actually doesn't sound bad to me.
No, it's fun. This is one of the first, might be the first. I didn't do any research, but it's certainly, if not the first, one of the first of those sort of 1950s atomic age, you know, giant bugs monster movies.
It's a B film, right?
Very much, very okay. much. It's one of the first, and it's probably my favorite.
Nice.
Of those.
Why is it still low then?
I don't love those kinds of movies.
Oh, okay. So this is a preference of style in general.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's just generally better made than a lot of them. There's a little bit more story, a little bit more character work done.
Yeah.
And it was slightly larger budget. You know, as happens with a lot of films that become very popular and do well, you'll get knockoffs. You'll get a lot of films, like after Star Wars came out, a lot of low-budget sci-fi films just trying to capitalize on that success. And there were a lot of films that tried to capitalize off of this success. And some of them are fun, good times, mm-hmm. B-movies. But I tend to like a little bit more quality.
That's fair.
In my films.
Wow. You know what's funny? As soon as you said 1950s, I was like, I took a breath. And of all of the types of films of the 1950s, that's my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
I have the last film I watched like that, though. I was a kid. And I think it's a nostalgia, not necessarily for the film, but for this moment. I was a kid and I was watching, it's a movie about giant ants. It was clearly a B movie in black and white about giant ants. I was watching with my grandpa. And I remember, is this it?
I think this is probably it.
Holy shit, really?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. I remember watching with my grandpa, and it was, I'm sure the memory is very much connected with my grandpa.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just silly. It was silly, and it was fun. And at the time, I think I was just happy to hang out with my grandpa and watch this thing that I never saw. But I remember giant ants. I remember it looking like I wasn't afraid of it because it looked so fucking goofy. That's all I remember of it, giant ants. So this actually might be the same movie.
I would not be surprised. I am trying to think of another giant ants movie, and I can't think of one.
I immediately go to Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, but I think that's the opposite of a giant ant. It's more like a
normal-sized ant.
Yeah, normal-sized ants, tiny person.
Itty-bitty person.
It's all about perspective. I'm actually not afraid to watch this movie.
No, it's fun. Okay. I enjoy it. Great cast. Edmund Gwenn's a great character actor. He's been in a bunch of stuff. And actually, James Whitmore, who I'm sure you don't know the name of, but he played Brooks in Shawshank Redemption.
Oh, the old guy?
Yeah, the old guy. He was at one point in his life not old.
That doesn't make sense.
Right?
Old people have always been old.
That's he was one of the leads in this. Nice. But yeah, it's a good sound design. It was nominated for an Oscar for Best Special Effects.
Nice. For its time.
For its time.
For its time.
Oh boy, is it silly fun nowadays.
When, you know what's interesting is, I'm sorry, I don't want to get on too much of a tangent.
Go for it.
But how we adapt to technology visually. Mm-hmm. Like, I remember The Matrix being the shit when it, I keep talking about the fucking Matrix.
You do keep talking about
the Matrix. I think because I'm a Keanu kick right now. But, okay, I won't use the Matrix. I remember other action movies.
Oh, boy.
Looking like, they just look, remember, like, you, it looked better? Like, okay, when we watched Pagemaster.
There's a big difference in visual quality between Pagemaster and The Matrix.
I agree.
The Matrix looks a lot better than Pagemaster.
I agree. But as a kid, though, it felt like it popped off the screen. Mm-hmm. It looked great. And then when we became old and we watched it again, it was just like... Like, okay, when Tron first came out. I'll use Tron. Okay. When that first came out, people lost their shit, right? Like, that was crazy.
It was impressive.
Impressive for its time.
Yeah.
Now it is embarrassing to watch. It is sad.
The effects do not hold up very well.
No.
At all.
I just, it's weird. The end.
Oh, it was a nice, I was a nice tangent. I agree. And there's a certain charm, yeah, I think, with a lot of these, especially from the 50s science fiction films, those kinds of special effects, I think are just really charming.
Yeah.
They're easy to enjoy, even if they're not good by today's standards.
Did it scare people in the time? Like, was it, you know what I mean?
I don't know. I've heard conflicting, like, accounts. Some people say, yeah, oh yeah, no, that was scary, because, you know, that's...
For the time.
For the time. That's just, that's what we had to look forward to being scared by. Other times, or other accounts I've heard, you know, I worked at a senior center for quite some time. I've heard a fair number of stories. Guys just be like, nah, we weren't really scared, but we would have to drive in with our girlfriends or our dates, and, you know, it was just an excuse to, like, oh, and, like, get close to each other. Like, we weren't actually scared. It was just, like, it was all part of the act.
I kind of call bullshit. Mostly because of, was it the train robber?
That was in the 1800s.
I know, but...
And no one had seen anything like that before.
That must have been crazy for people.
Right? A moving picture was hard to comprehend.
That's like the, what, like going into VR now?
Yeah, yeah. Can you imagine, like, in the 1950s, you put on this thing and you're just in another place?
Yeah, but I'm calling bullshit because... Obviously, for the 50s, they would look back and say that's silly. But for their time, whatever was going on in their time, I would imagine was the peak of what they were experiencing. So I'm calling bullshit. I think those guys were afraid. Fuck them.
Well, if you end up watching the film, we might reevaluate.
That's fair. Okay. 470.
That was 479. Them. It was a fun movie.
Yes.
Number 478.
Gross.
Director Roger Spotswood. 1997 film, Tomorrow Never Dies.
Wait, that was James Bond?
That was a James Bond movie. Can't you tell by the title?
Yeah, yeah. Tomorrow Never Dies. That's with...
Pierce Brosnan.
Yeah, was that the double... The Nintendo 64, that was around the same...
That was GoldenEye. That was the film right before this.
Okay.
GoldenEye was Pierce's first... We're on first name basis. First... shot at James Bond. This was the follow-up to the second film where he played James Bond. Tomorrow Never Dies.
Okay. I have seen the Daniel Craig... I've seen Casino Royale with you.
Mm-hmm.
You made me skip the one after Casino Royale.
And did
then,
I?
Yep. You said, don't watch it. And I said, okay. Then I think I saw Skyfall.
Mm-hmm.
And I love Casino Royale. I enjoyed Skyfall. Every other James Bond thing you have shown me, I fucking don't like. It's weird. It is rapey. It's super rapey.
Especially the early films. Yeah. Yeah.
He literally rapes a woman, doesn't he? Like on paper, what it is
rape. Yeah. Oh yeah.
He rapes her into loving him or something.
It's a good movie though.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. No. A lot of those early Sean Connery films and the Roger Moore, the early James Bond movies. A little gross by today's standards. Even some of the more modern.
Yeah.
Actually, basically all.
Yeah.
Every, even the ones that you listed that you liked, James Bond movies, are a little gross.
Yes.
Yeah.
The
series is a gross series.
And then going back to that thing that we... First off, this is not... I know I keep making these critiques of the films. The more this goes on, the more I'm like, it's a movie. It just is a movie. It's for its time. It's by a particular perspective. Like, it's fine. Okay, this is going back to that visceralness. I'm okay with Daniel Craig's Bond because the world feels more real.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, when he's doing the stuff he's doing, it doesn't feel like... There's this... don't know how to explain it. Like, I guess I like films that... It either has to go so ridiculous like RoboCop for me to be able to kind of accept the silliness, or be so real and gritty so it doesn't take me out of what's going on. Anything in that middle ground throws me off. Mm. And those Sean Connery films kind of feel that way.
Oh, yeah. They definitely fall in that middle ground.
Yeah, of like... It's goofy and campy, but it's trying to be suave and kind of serious and debonair.
Yeah.
And it just hits this really uncomfortable place for me.
It does. I don't blame you in the slightest. I feel, honestly, I feel kind of guilty for liking some of those films that I do enjoy. Because, yeah, like, we'll come across one of those scenes. I'm like, I just want to skip this so yeah. I can get to the fun stuff. Guy throwing a hat at people.
This like it looked like was it a blade hat or something?
Yeah, there was a blade on around the rim.
Jesus. You know what's crazy? Is right now I'm leaning towards the fucking B film from 1950.
We haven't even talked about this film.
I know.
You just know it's a James Bond
film. I just know it's a James Bond film, and I'm already like, yeah, I'm going with the Ant movie.
From what I remember, this is one of the less rapey ones.
Oh, it's not even about rape or anything. It's more like... James Bond does not interest me that much. Mm-hmm. But I'm listening.
Okay, well, yeah, let's get into it a little bit. The film is not considered one of the better ones, mm-hmm. but I really like it. And a lot of people have a problem with the villain and the villain's like scheme as being stupid. It's one of my favorite James Bond villain schemes.
Is it the water supply?
It is not the water supply.
Okay.
I think... That was the one... That was the Daniel Craig one that we skipped.
Yeah.
It's about a newspaper man who's trying to start a war to sell newspapers.
Is this a fucking joke?
No.
Okay. When did this come out?
97.
Okay.
Like, news conglomerate, not just like newspaper.
Okay, I was picturing like a fleet of like boys on bikes... No. Just taking all of the newspapers. No one's going to have the news.
Imagine that, but on a grander, larger world scale.
Right.
Okay. He's trying to start some kind of conflict to spur interest. It's silly.
Yeah.
But they play it so well. And it's just really enjoyable. Jonathan Pryce is the villain. Carver. I just really enjoy him. He's a great character actor. The whole film is filled with great character actors. Ricky Jay, the late great Ricky Jay. Who was supposed to be in Knives Out. He died while that was in production. And then he got replaced by another great character actor, Emmett Walsh. Vincent Schiavelli, just a great, great supporting cast. Really great, fun character actors. Michelle Yeoh is one of the more kick-ass Bond girls. She's like another spy. And it's just a really fun James Bond movie. One of the more fun ones without being so silly that I roll my eyes at it.
Yeah.
There's a lot of those James Bond movies, and those are enjoyable in their own way, but they're not my favorites.
That's fair.
This rides a nice middle ground of being silly, fun, but I can take it just seriously enough where I'm engaged.
Shockingly enough, I'm still leaning towards the Ants.
That's fine. I just wanted to get out why I like it.
Okay.
Should we go on to 477? Because we know you're not going to pick number 478.
Pretty confident. But we'll see. We'll see.
We'll see. Number 477, you might have seen, actually.
Okay.
From director Larry Charles, his 2008 film, Religious.
Oh.
With Bill Maher.
Oh. I think I had to watch it in college once.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember being irritated by Bill Maher.
Yeah.
Why the fuck is this on your list?
As a documentary, it's terrible.
Okay.
It is one of the more manipulative. Yeah. Like, in the way it's edited. It is insincere. It's not a good documentary.
No.
I think it's really funny, though.
I don't remember. I was in class.
Fair. I think when viewed as a comedy...
Mm-hmm.
I find it enjoyable. It's there's a lot of funny moments, little vignettes, and I'm not always able to. If I'm able to turn off that part of my brain that views this as real,
mm-hmm.
I can enjoy it and have a really good time with it. I'm not always able to do that, though.
Right.
And it is a terrible documentary, which is why it's this low on this list.
Right.
Yeah, I think it is very funny. But I have problems with it.
Huh. Wow. This has actually been the most shocking film on your list for me so far.
That's it. Oh, that's interesting.
I'm trying to think if there was... Was there any other movie I was, like, surprised by? I think I was surprised by... Osmosis Jones, but I wasn't even. I think I just forgot about
it. Right, that wasn't like this is on your list. Like, oh yeah, that movie.
And I'm not even mad that you put. I don't remember anything from it, but it's just weird. I actually would never expect you to put something like this on your list.
I'm happy to surprise you.
Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah. Wow. This is actually really hard.
Oh, and one more critique of the film, just to make it that much more enjoyable.
Yeah.
It gets way too serious at the end. For how silly it is throughout the film and how, like, kind of like, at the end it gets, like, super, like, religion must die. I'm like, okay, simmer down. It leaves a bad taste in my mouth when I'm done.
Wow.
Why is it on this list, Bryce?
Yeah, I'm blown away by this. And it's, I mean, fuck. This is actually really tough.
Really?
Between the ant movie and Religious. I'll explain why, because you're making a face at me.
Well, you seem not terribly interested in Religious at all. So.
No, I'm curious. Mm. I think because it's on your list, it's making me especially... Like, the B film from the 50s, I'm like, yeah, of course that's on fucking Bryce's list. Why wouldn't that be on Bryce's list? But Religious is so out of left field for me, for who you are. I'm curious. I'm really... I haven't watched it in so long. I remember him going to Israel...
He goes to a lot of places, a lot of religious sites.
Right. I remember someone dressed up as Jesus and walking around.
Yeah, that was at Holy Land or Bible Land or Jesus Land or whatever that is in Florida.
Yeah.
Just out Orlando, just by Disney World, there's a religious theme park.
Oh, fuck. I actually might pick Religious. I know. Out of just raw curiosity.
You could enjoy a slice of your childhood. Look back in a 1950s film.
I don't know. I think what's averting me from doing that is fucking up the memory, if I'm being honest.
Yeah?
I have a really good memory with my grandpa watching that movie.
Mm.
And I think I'm afraid of, like, rewatching it in another context in different... headspace and then forever looking at that memory different, and I don't think I want to do that.
Sure.
So I think this is weird. This is a weird episode. I think I'm gonna go with Religious, surprisingly enough.
Well, hot damn.
Yeah, this is gonna get weird.
Though the only film on this in this episode that you haven't seen is the James Bond movie.
Yeah, but I don't remember any of these movies. That's fair. I would have had...
I'll let it stay.
Had I seen Religious recently, or if I remembered anything from it, I just remember Bill Murray. I don't watch him often, but I remember him being smarmy. Like, this ego, slimy, and, like, he's really pretentious, looking down on people was the vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I don't remember anything from the movie. I just remember him. I remember there's something about him where I was like, you're funny. I acknowledge that you're funny, but there's something about you that's so disturbingly unlikable.
I think you've described him to a T.
Really?
And in this film, to a T.
Oh, good. I'm glad I remember him.
Yeah, well, he is, I'd say, even though it's about religion, I'd say he's the focus.
That's, okay.
It has admittedly been a fair number of years since I've watched this. I think...
You think in a modern context with all the shit going on, it might...
It might fall off my list.
Really?
It might.
Huh. I'm sorry. This is weird. I don't know. This is weird. This is very different. I think it's also good that we're throwing in a documentary that, like, instead of just this classic narrative, something, spice it up, something different... I'm just actually, like, I don't know, I'm just very curious.
All right, Aaron.
Yeah.
You've decided?
Yeah.
I'm kind of scared myself. This might end up being like a stuntman where I go, actually.
Oh, did that end up happening?
Well, I told you, yeah, I think that that wouldn't be on my list if I were to redo it. And this very well might be the same thing. It, that might happen throughout the 400s.
I can see that.
While I'm watching, like, oh, you know what? Actually.
Yeah.
And that's the thing with these. Like, when you look at this many movies, it's kind of hard to take them all into account.
Yeah.
And to have them all fresh in your mind. You're like, yeah, I like that. And then I can just kind of put it where I feel like it would be.
I'm blown away that you've been able to even organize it up to this point.
It's, let me tell you, it was a task. It was an endeavor.
When I try to tell people what we're doing, they're like, 500? Who does that? Nobody understand. Like, I try to describe it, and they're like, that's fucking dumb. But
it is.
It is very, all of it. This whole thing is dumb.
But I told you we should cut it down to like 200.
I'm enjoying myself.
Oh boy.
In a weird way, in a sadistic, like,
sadistic. You just got to watch RoboCop.
I did get to watch RoboCop, so I'm feeling good. I'm rolling the dice on Religulous.
Well, I hope luck's in your favor. Luck Thanks. Be your lady tonight.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, Aaron. No, sit the fuck down. I haven't done the outro
There's
yet.
An outro. Okay.
Yeah. Leading into the intermission.
Right.
All right, Aaron. Let's go watch director Larry Charles's 2018, god damn it, 2008 film, Religions. So, Aaron.
Yes, Bryce.
That was rough.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me about Religious.
Religious is a, I'm going to call it a faux documentary. A comical documentary. A mockumentary.
Not a mockumentary. I'd say comical documentary is a good way to put it.
It's a comical documentary that goal is to, I would say, prove the unnecessary, how do I put this? I feel like he's trying to prove that we are going backwards by having religion even exist in society, and that in order to move forward and not continue bloodshed or wars, we must everyone should abandon religion and move forward as agnostic or atheist, I think is what he was getting at.
I'd say that's a decent summarization.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I guess to speak on it as a film, just taking out of biased and just what it is as a film.
Okay.
As a documentary, I think it is not good.
It is not good. Yeah. It is bad.
It is pretty bad.
It is a bad documentary.
It started off really entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
So I started off very engaged and interested in what was going on, whether I agreed or I disagreed.
It was manipulative from the start, but like you said, it was engaging, entertaining. Yeah.
And then it slowly became one note. I started to realize the pattern here.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, okay, so Bill Maher is going to go to a place. He's going to talk to a person who believes in some sort of religion. If the person if he agrees with the person in any way, he usually will not make fun of them.
I just kind of let them talk.
He lets them talk, and he doesn't edit or anything. It just is what it is. If he disagrees, he'll I don't know if he will, but whoever, the director, will cut in edits, or they'll add thought bubbles, I guess is the best way to describe them, that make fun of the person that he disagrees with.
Mm-hmm.
And it kept doing that. And it got to a point where it was like, well, I know what you're going to do, and I'm not interested anymore, because we're doing the same thing over and over again.
Same thing over and over, and so regularly.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't let up. It's not like, oh, it's something that they do throughout, but is only sprinkled throughout. It's like every scene.
Yeah, he could have, that document, as a documentary, it could have used more narrative. Like, in the sense that any one of those clips could have been put in any point, and it wouldn't have changed the documentary. If he had started off the same way and ended it the same way, and then everything was shifted around, it didn't change what it was. Does that make sense?
It does. It does. Yeah, I think they were smart to go the route that they did for a Western audience. You start with something more familiar, Christianity, and you really focus on that for like 2/3 of the film, and all the different types of Christianity. Not all the different types, but several different types. And then you get into the more quote-unquote exotic religions.
Yeah, Muslim, I want to say, they got into.
Well, at the end, I think they ended with Muslim. Islam. They briefly touch on Scientology.
Really briefly.
Touch on Mormonism.
Yeah, also brief.
Also relatively brief. But, yeah, I...
Is it? I'm guessing it's not on your list anymore.
It's not going to be on my list anymore.
Just as a documentary, as a film, taking out all the bias, it is a bad film.
It is. Well, I mean, I guess that's what you get when you get the director of Borat to make a documentary.
Oh, you don't like Borat?
It's not on my list.
I actually really enjoy Borat.
I'm glad you do.
And I enjoy Bruno.
I haven't seen Bruno.
I might have to show you
Bruno. Okay.
Either way, but to take outside of that, because that's really all I have to say about it as a film. It's just kind of sloppy. Starts off very entertaining and engaging, mostly out of shock.
Sure.
And then it slowly loses its edge because we're repeating itself.
It ebbs and flows like in the first half. I'm like, okay, and then it starts losing me, and then it brings in a couple of the people he talks with are really.
Batshit crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The senator was fun.
Oof. Yeah. Do you want to get into the individual
thing? If you want to.
All right. I'm going to start off by saying I want to acknowledge my bias, and that is I do identify as Christian, but I identify as a Christian that Christians dislike. Does that make sense?
Well, you might have to. I understand, but you might have to explain it.
So my own personal beliefs are. I call myself a Christian mostly because that is the religion that I grew up with and I have the most understanding and knowledge about, and that my beliefs are that this is my faith and my general belief system. I think that all other religions probably have, including, I don't know if you call atheism a religion, but...
I think technically it means lack of religion. So
I'm going to call it a religion for the sake of this.
A belief system.
A belief system. I think all belief systems have, including in a weird way, Scientology or Mormonism or whatever, have a legitimate basis in their own perspectives. And I think that I just like to say Christianity is a nice, simple way to umbrellatize it. That's not a word, but you know.
I understand.
And that I don't personally believe I am right. In fact, I think that chances are I'm probably wrong, or maybe I have some inkling of accuracy that is muddy with my own perspective and bias. So that's before I even start. Just know that's my bias here. I think that my main issue with this is how he started this film off, which was, it had the veneer of genuine and sincere.
Trying to understand these
people. Yeah, that's how he did it. Mm-hmm. And it's like, no, you aren't. Like,
you're just trying to make fun of them.
Yeah, yeah. It was like, if he had gone in like, look, I don't like religion, and I'm going to mock every single one of them, I'd say, okay.
I'd be much more forgiving of this film.
Absolutely. I'd be like, yeah, go for it. Because there's a lot of moments where I'm 100%... He's so justified in making fun of them. But he starts it off as if he actually gives a shit. Or as if his mind could even be changed. He starts it off that way.
And that's the weird thing. It's like, that's like one of the first things he says.
Yeah.
But then... We cut right to him just mocking these people.
Yes.
It's not even like he eases into it, like trying to understand, but then starts mocking them. He just, from the get-go.
Starts mocking them.
Yeah.
And there were times when the mocking to me was needless and malicious and unjustified. Mm-hmm. And then there were times when the mocking was 100% justified.
Yeah.
So like the ones that were 100% justified, and the one that actually irritates me the most is the Holy... Land.
Oh yeah, the Holy Land experience.
Holy Land experience. So basically, there's this place in Florida. It's Disneyland for creepy Christians. You go there, and they have attractions, if you can call it that. But the thing that actually, and I wouldn't say I get offended easily.
No, you don't.
I would the what they did, I think, actually offends me. There's a scene where they're replaying Jesus's crucifixion, and it's cutting between watching this guy playing Jesus, who is white as fuck, by the way, which really annoyed me.
Not surprised. Yeah. Not that you're annoyed, and not that he's super white.
Yeah, I was like that. Whatever. And all the Romans were white. Everyone was white, apparently, in Egypt. I didn't know that, but
you never read the Bible.
I never read the Bible, clearly. But so they're doing Jesus's crucifixion, and then they have all these people sitting and watching. And I know that doesn't sound that big of like that's that big of a deal.
Just how graphic it is.
Yeah.
Graphic, and then it's juxtaposed along with a song that a woman's singing.
Yeah,
and people are videotaping it.
Yeah. They had camcorders.
Yeah.
And it felt... South Park said it the best. This was when Passion of the Christ came out. I want to say Stan's character says something to the effect of, you should celebrate what Jesus did and taught, not how he fucking died. It was really disturbing to watch these people, these wholesome people, sit and just watch this man be fucking beaten and murdered. Blood everywhere, clapping. And so that, to me, is disturbing. And I think every single one of them deserves to be mocked. But the film starts off when he's at this truck stop. He's at this this truck stop church, if you can call it. It's like an outhouse, but a church.
It's like a flatbed, like boxcar.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just...
It's a church inside of a truck.
It's fucking embarrassing. It's fucking embarrassing and sad. And these are all guys who are clearly not very intelligent, really uneducated. And I know this is Bill Maher's thing, is that he makes fun of idiots. I get it. And these people are idiots. They're idiots. They're just dumb. But to start the film off, as if to say, like, I'm going to go in with an open mind and an open heart. That's kind of how he started it off. And he starts it off with his mom and his sister. Mm-hmm. And at first, I was like, this is actually kind of likable. Like, they're talking about their experience in the church and why they left. And there's nothing that made perfect sense. And then it got to the truck stop guys. And I was hoping he would just sit and listen to them. But he doesn't do that. He shits on them pretty hard from what I see. And it's like, can you just let them believe? Look at their lives. Bill, you have so much money. You're fine. You're comic. You're charming. You're moderately attractive, I guess. I don't know.
Sure.
These guys were... But the guys in the church were like...
You're mocking the way they look?
Yeah.
Oh, you're just like Bill Maher.
I'm just like Bill Maher. No, but Bill has a perfectly privileged life. And so he's going into this fucking place where he's shitting on these people whose lives are not good. If they need a higher power, whether you believe it or not, if it is keeping them on the straight and narrow and keeping them out of crime and hurting people, let them be fucking stupid. Let them. Go for it. They're not doing anything. So I think that that's a fucked up way to start your documentary. It's fucked up and it's weird. But then when he interviews the senator, of Arkansas?
Yeah.
It's totally justified in making fun of that guy. That guy should not be in a place of power. He should not, like, there's a point where he's like, well, you don't need to pass an IQ test to be a senator. And I was like, oh, that's not good. So, yeah, it was like, I think he was, I guess if I were to boil down my issues, it would be fake sincerity.
In the beginning.
In the beginning.
And the end.
In the end, fake sincerity in the beginning and the end, because fake sincerity in the beginning and the end, mocking people, and this is a connection to the sincerity, mocking people that didn't deserve to be mocked, and not mocking the people that he agreed with. That part really bothered me. That if you're gonna pull, like, that's what I respect about South Park, is that they'll make fun of themselves, they make fun of everybody, no one, they make fun of atheists, Christians, Muslims, Scientology, everybody's fair game. Bill Maher, only the people that are fair game to Bill Maher are the people that he disagrees with. And that annoys me.
To be fair, he did use some comic cutaways even with some of the people he was agreeing with. It wasn't to that extent. Like the the astronomer priest in the Vatican.
Yes.
He used some comedic cutaways. He was ribbing with them a little bit, but not to the extent.
Yeah. It didn't feel malicious.
Right.
And it felt like the people that he agreed with, while he made jokes, he presented them as intelligent through editing and through the way he would do the interview.
The editing especially.
God damn, the
editing. I've said it before. I've said it probably a dozen times at this point. Very manipulative.
Yeah.
Even though I realized that when I first saw it,
and
when I put it on my list originally, I was able to look past it. For some reason, it was a lot harder this time. I think it's been quite a few years since I'd seen it.
Because we're older.
Yeah. Older, a little bit more mature understanding.
Yeah. Actually, you know what? I think younger me, if you were to take out my religious beliefs, younger me would have loved this. Older me, it just feels mean and not in a fun way. And his argument at the end,
so unjustified, given everything that's come before it.
Mm-hmm. His argument at the end was like, essentially, religion is going to bring upon the apocalypse. In a weird way. In like a nuclear apocalypse. Mm-hmm. Like our belief systems and different religions are going to bring upon war and it's going to destroy the world. Which, first off, totally possible. Yeah. I'm not disputing that. But it was just overblown, exaggerated. It really fear-mongering.
Yeah.
Like that he was just showing cutaways of bombs exploding and people speaking in tongues and weird religious practices. It was just manipulative and gross. And I'm not even saying that as someone who identifies as Christian. Like, I don't mind him making fun of the people that deserve to be made fun of. It's just biased and weird. Just make a movie. Don't make a documentary, because when you make a documentary, obviously there is slant and there's bias.
Almost every documentary.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Make a fucking movie then, because documentaries present themselves to the best of their ability as factual or not logical, but...
Just trying to, like, even if they have an agenda, like, here is our thesis, but they go about it in a way that at least appears to try to be balanced and fair to all parties.
Yes.
This film does not do that.
No, it doesn't.
And if it did, like, either make a narrative film, make it a comedy, which would be fine, probably pretty funny.
Yeah.
Or make a documentary.
Yeah.
And just don't be so manipulative. Don't be so transparent with your bias. And with you editing people to make them look even stupider than they are, to make you look even wittier than you are.
Yeah.
It's just, if he tackled the same subject matter with a little bit more care and attempted understanding, and still made fun of some of these people.
Yes.
It probably would be still in my top 500, because I like the subject.
Yes.
And there are some good moments in the film.
Great moments. Fucking hilarious moments, actually.
Great individual scenes and sequences that are very good. And some little tidbits, little nuggets.
Mm-hmm.
But as a whole, big picture, looking back on it all, it's gross.
Yeah, it's gross. I think, you know, the other thing that bothered me was that he clearly tricked a lot of these people into being in this movie.
Oh, yeah. A lot of people did not know what they were getting themselves into, did not know the purpose of this documentary. And I wonder, do you think that... Because, like, the beginning and ending were filmed at the same location. Do you think he started there? Maybe not. But that he... When he initially set out, like, I'm going to try to understand. And then, like, he met some people and was just like, uh-uh. And just, like, slipped into making fun of these people because that's...
That's his thing, I guess. I don't know. I really don't know.
Maybe he originally intended to set out to make something where he...
I hope that was the case. I really hope that he did intend to just try to open his mind up, and then he kept meeting idiots, and then he just became cynical. I really hope that was the case. Because if that was the case, and we'll never know, if that was the case, then I get it a little more, but the editing was still fucked up.
it's the director of Borat. Never mind. No, they knew what they were getting themselves into.
And you know, was another good example of just being like unnecessarily malicious was the gay. What was that? What is that called? The
fixing ministry of the. I can't remember.
But so Bill Maher goes and he interviews a ex gay man.
No. He is a heterosexual man who has dealt with homosexuality in his past.
Yes, that's what he said. And first off, this guy is gay as the day is long. This man is gay. I don't give a fuck. He is gay.
He's a gay man.
He's a gay man, and he married a lesbian, and they had kids. And so. I know this is a comedy, and I know I'm about to take a comedy way too seriously, but it's just because these are real people. Like, I don't know that guy personally, but he's probably gay. Probably very, very gay. Yeah. And he's been brainwashed to believe that he would go to hell if he were to exist the way he would feel most comfortable, so it is his wife. And now he has children. God only knows what happened to those kids. And he was that to me, that's a guy who is a victim of religion. That's a guy who, it wasn't like the in the Holy Land, the guy who's playing Jesus. Make fun of him all you want. Fuck that guy. Yeah. By all means, make fun of him. That guy is a fucking idiot who decided that he could grow out his hair and be Jesus. Or the guy, the Mexican guy who actually believes he is.
Do you think he actually believes?
No. Well, I don't know. He's a grifter.
The Reverend.
The black guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are the guys. Go get them. Fucking
open season.
Fuck those guys who are taking people's money, who are using religion to manipulate and fuck with people. By all means, tear them apart.
If that was the entire focus of documentary, and if it was the same movie, only it was just those people, I think I'd be able to enjoy it.
So. Absolutely. Yeah. If he was mocking those people, of course. But this is a guy who he's a fucking victim of this shit. Like,
the gay man.
The gay guy. Yeah, the gay guy's a victim of this shit. And to go in and for him to clearly be in denial about his own sexuality, and you're just fucking mocking him, it's like, well, stop being so high and mighty then. You're on the same level as the rest of these people if you're going to put this guy down.
That was something at the end that I loved, him saying that we need more humility.
Oh, yeah. That was...
We need to be humble.
The fucking irony behind that. He keeps hiding behind the I don't know. Mm-hmm. He keeps saying that, and I...
You seem pretty confident.
Yeah.
If you're an atheist, and you don't believe, like, adamantly don't believe, that's fine.
Yes.
Don't
bullshit me.
Yeah.
Don't say he started off agnostic in the I don't know what's gonna happen, but here's all these facts and fuck you and all this stuff. So, but to be in the interest of being fair and balanced, I do want to say though that the religious people arguing against him, the dumb ones.
Oh yes.
Oh my God. So like, I'm a manipulative person. I think you'd agree, Bryce.
Sure.
And I think that comedy and comedians can use charm and humor to be even more manipulative.
That's how storytelling goes.
Yes. So when Bill Maher goes in and he starts questioning people and picking people apart, the misstep that all of these people made, the misstep that all these people made was speaking in absolutes. If they had come in more humble and said, you know, I don't know, but this is my faith and this is my beliefs and here's why. And they didn't try to say, well, blood samples from Jesus' tomb and some dumb shit like that.
The Shroud of Turin, Aaron?
Yeah, that, whatever. like some of these other people, when they would argue against him, they were trying to use science to justify magic. That's what religion is. It's magic. It's mysticism. And you can't... Those don't mix. Mm-hmm. I think the best person he interviewed, and he didn't really make fun of him, was the astrologist priest.
Yeah, the astronomer.
Astronomy. That's a different thing. The astronomist priest, who was like, look, scientifically speaking, you can't argue for religion in that way. This is a faith thing. This is your feelings, and those are separate things. He broke it down.
There was a section where, like, between... the gospel, like the original gospel, mm-hmm. or the Old Testament, the New Testament were written, and then how long after that until we got to modern science, the yeah. scientific method, and yes. understanding our world in a scientific way, and how separate those two yeah. time periods were, and how they just cannot...
you can't mix them.
No. It's one like, cannot justify...
It was oil and vinegar?
I don't think... Maybe he mentioned that.
No, oil and vinegar don't mix. When you put them in a yeah, cup, yeah. they yeah, separate.
Oil flows to the top.
Oil flows to the top, vinegar sticks to the bottom. It's the same way in that they just... You cannot connect the two. They're separate things. And you know what? Bill Maher, statistically speaking... Well, not even statistics. I don't know if it's stats. But Bill Maher, logically speaking, is probably right. I'm probably an idiot, and I don't know what I'm talking about. And when I die, I go... It all goes black. Probably...
Oh, man.
I know.
And then here I am, an atheist, for those of you who don't know, wishing I hope I'm wrong. That'd be great if there's something afterwards.
I didn't know you were atheist. I thought you were agnostic.
I used to say I'm sort of like an agnostic deist.
That's interesting.
Yeah, where like maybe there's something out there, but I don't think it's anything that a formal religion...
Could ever.
Maybe. Yeah, like if there is something, some kind of higher power, I don't think it's... Gonna be Christianity or Islam or
that's fair.
Scientology.
Yeah, I really want to make it clear. Like, I acknowledge it's totally possible. I'm probably wrong. Probably wrong. I'm probably very, very wrong in my belief system. But I think I actually do come at it with a set of humility, where I think that, like, okay, if we use science, right? We're gonna use science to back my argument. The universe is this ever-expanding, all-encompassing thing. There's nothing but something outside of the universe. There's black holes, there's time, there's multiple dimensions. There's all this stuff that we don't understand, scientifically, spiritually, anything. There's all this stuff that we don't understand. And the way that Bill Maher goes about this, he implies, like, but I'm right. And I don't like that. If you're gonna... If that's what you're going to do, if you're going to say, I'm right and I'm going to make fun of these people, then steer into that.
Right.
If this is about learning about other people's beliefs, then steer into that. If this is just for comedy, then just steer into that.
No false pretensions.
Yeah, yeah. He just... It was just fucking gross. It was a really gross thing to watch.
Yeah.
And I don't regret... picking this film?
I don't either. It was kind of an eye-opener for me.
Yeah.
Rewatching it.
I wouldn't... It's funny. I wouldn't even say I disliked it. I enjoyed myself in the sense that I'm enjoying this conversation. Mm-hmm. I guess it achieved its goal in creating conversation about it, but not in the way I think was very productive.
Not in the way it intended, I'm sure.
Yeah, yeah. I guess that's really all I would suggest. If you are an atheist, I would actually highly suggest you watch it to see how you feel. Like, it's like when I see things like, okay, so if I identify as Christian and I see movies like God's Not Dead or whatever,
yeah,
that shit annoys me.
Yeah.
As a Christian, that shit annoys me. And I wonder if most atheists would watch this and be like, okay, this isn't fair. Right. I'm actually really curious, and I think that anybody that gives a shit about religion, whether you agree with it or disagree with it, should watch the movie, but watch it with an incredibly high level of critical thought.
Yes, very much so. Don't get pulled in by its snake oil salesmanship.
Yeah. So that's I don't regret watching the film, but it was not a good film, not a good documentary.
No, definitely not a good documentary. I used to think I can turn my brain off and enjoy it as a comedy, but now even I don't think I can do that. I guess that it is what it is. One more film that I'm definitely going to remove from my top 500.
Cool. Are we gonna, in 10 years, are we going to redo this?
I might let you know what I've changed.
Okay.
And maybe we do like a top 100, but I ain't.
That's fair.
I'm not doing all this over again.
I don't know. Maybe we'll get bored.
We'll see.
All right.
So, Aaron, yes. Would you recommend 2008's Religious?
In a weird way, yeah.
Oh, my God.
In a weird way, yes.
All right. Well, Aaron, I think next episode we're going to have a better time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think so.
It is what it is.
It is what it is. I'm glad, in a weird way, like you said, I'm glad you picked this one. Mm. We're better for it. Okay. And until next time, Aaron.
Till next time.
This has been a Buddy System presentation of Film Favorites.